Welcome to Ask Al, presented by Quad Plus. I like today's question. Can semiconductors age? And if so, how to identify and what tips do you have for replacing devices? So let's talk about the two main packages that are available in semiconductors today. The PUC package, primarily used for diodes, SCRs, GTOs, IGCTs, and so these are live at both sides, and you typically see them clamped between two heat sinks. Now, the next package is the isolated base package. They're used across the board, so multiple device technologies internally, and they're generally mounted to a heat sink that's at ground potential. So let's start talking about PUC aging. I've had experiences where I've been working with customers and they've told me that they've replaced entire sets of devices based on an engineer indicating that there's been some type of aging effect which is causing their problem. Let's be clear about one thing. A multimeter cannot determine anything with regard to the aging effects on semiconductors. In fact, the only thing a multimeter can be used for is to determine if the device is shorted or if the gate is open. What you'll find if you look at semiconductors, even within one batch, the anode cathode impedances and the gate impedances vary widely. So the meter won't really tell you anything about the condition other than a go, no-go type test. Now, there's other problems when you're measuring in a circuit, and you see here there's divergent paths for current to flow. And so you've got snubber capacitors and snubber resistors. You've got input devices, you've got gate drivers, you've got your DC bus, and then also the output devices. So just putting a meter across the device, again, we'll tell you if it's short and that's it. Now, I've never used and nor would I ever recommend anyone use a Megger to test a semiconductor device. Quite frankly, the risk to personal safety is not worth the payback, in that the reading you get is not going to tell you anything about the absolute condition. You can get the exact same information, much safer, using a multimeter. So, in general, I would be very suspect of replacing semiconductors based strictly on a statement of weakness based on field measurements. Here's a PUC device, and so this particular device is rated at 3600 volts, 3800 amps, and as you can see, I mean, it's just an absolutely brilliant package. One heat sink on one side, heat sink on the other side, clamped together. You've got great cooling available with heat sinks on each side and airflow up each heat sink. So a very neat package. Now let's look inside one of these devices. Now this particular device is a GTO. What I've done is I've removed this, one of the poles, pole faces. And so as you can see, I take the first cover off and now I'm actually exposed the silicon chip. Now if you look inside, and again, just an absolutely brilliant package, you can see this is the gate along the circular area, and then the anode cathode up here. And you can see in this device it's actually failed. And typically you can actually tell when you look inside one of these devices what the probability of the failures were. And that if it's failed along the outside rings, typically it's going to be related to voltage. And if it's failed in towards the gate area, then you know it's a turn on or turn off fault. And generally in the middle are I squared T type faults. Now, here's the isolated base package that I was referring to. And in this case, this is an IGBT. This particular unit rated 1200 volts and 3600 amps. And so, and then if you take the cover off, let's take a look under the hood, you'll see it's actually comprised of many different IGBTs, okay? And so, and they're all paralleled via the bus bars. Just an absolutely brilliant package and very effective at producing very, very high power levels in a relatively small area. Now, as I've always said, there's no moving parts inside the PUC. There's no moving parts inside the IGBT package. However, what has been found over time is that these little wires that are connecting in the modules that are connecting to each individual IGBT, what happens is when you have thermal transients, and so as you're heating the device up and cooling it down, those little wires have a tendency to move. So now there is a moving part inside the package. And what can happen over time is as that wire is continually expanding, contracting, it can break. And so ultimately, the device is no longer capable of carrying that rated current or supporting the rated voltage. Now this wire, this movement of the wire and the negative impacts from that typically ramify themselves in applications where there's cyclic loading. So for example, mill stands or any type of application where you're getting large load transients, where there's a very good cooling system. So for example, water cooled system where once you receive that very high amount of loading that the temperatures come back very quickly. And then also where the drive sizing versus the motor requirements is very tight. So you're operating the device right around its limits. So my answer to the first part of the question is, with regards to puck devices, I don't buy it. I haven't seen an A-B type test where I could say this device was weak, this device was strong, this device is aged, this device is not aged. Generally speaking, they either work or don't work. So if you're ever approached with those types of statements or those suggestions, what I would say is that you should ask more questions, but to generally be very leery of it. Now, with regards to modular devices, there is something there, and that's something that you're going to have to look at over time. And again, it comes down to what is your application and what are the thermal cycles that the device is experiencing. Okay, so now let's address the second part of the question, which was, what tips would I have for replacing semiconductors? So typically what I've experienced and what we've seen in the field, the errors, most common errors made, number one, too much compound used, number two, inadequate surface preparation, and number three, incorrect clamping force. So let's start with talking about surface preparation. The most important thing is to make sure that the heat sink is clean to brilliant. So you can do that either using steel wool or very, very fine sandpaper. Now, if there's any pitting on the heat sink, you're going to have to machine the surfaces of the heat sink again. The other thing to keep in mind is right after you have cleaned the surfaces of the heat sink, to apply the compound as soon as possible, as it only takes seconds for oxidization to begin to occur. And then a couple notes on compound. The purpose of the compound is threefold. Number one, provides thermal conduction. So, you know, the surfaces aren't perfectly flat, and so it will fill in the gaps. The other purpose is to provide lubrication. So, as I mentioned earlier, just on that micro motion of the expansion and contraction. And then finally, as to prevent oxidization on the heat sinks. Ultimately, if there starts to get oxidization, you're going to have insulation, and you'll start to crowd the current into other areas of the discs. With regards to the amount of compound to apply, most manufacturers specify a 1 mil thickness. Now, in practical terms, what that means is half a human hair. So you don't need a lot. And, you know, again, it's one of the biggest things we see go wrong in semiconductor replacement. In this case, more is not better. Now, when installing the semiconductor, make sure that the alignment pin lines up with the indentation on the device. Okay, let's talk about clamping your device. One common misconception is that it's a torque that you put on the screw, and that's absolutely not the case. What you're interested in is displacement of the spring, and that displacement is usually indicated by a tab becoming loose or an actual strain gauge and strain indicator on the clamp that will tell you when you've reached the proper force. So before you start torquing, it's important to make sure that the heat sink faces are parallel to each other, and you want to make sure that each bolt is inserted by the same amount. And then once you have the package snug, you can start putting 1/2 turn on each bolt until the device spring indicator says that it's reached its proper displacement. Now with modules, they're a bit easier to replace. However, you do need to be careful of the order in which you tighten the bolts. And just consulting the data sheets, manufacturers do specify the proper tightening order. And generally speaking, the larger the device, the larger that footprint is, the more critical that process is. So to summarize, when you're changing a semiconductor, there's really three things to be concerned with. Number one, keep it clean. Apply the compounds as soon as possible. Number two, don't apply too much compound. More is not better. And number three, be very attentive to the clamping forces on the device. So if you'd like assistance determining the root cause of semiconductor failures, or assistance machining surfaces or replacing semiconductors, just give us a call or send us an email. As always, if you have any other topics you'd like us to cover in our videos, just send me an email at al@quadplus.com. And remember, always work safe, lock out, and tag out. Thank you for watching.